I welcome you to the new session of the Laplace transform. In this session, we shall be today discussing about the convolution theorem, how we can calculate the Laplace transforms of two functions, where the two functions are interpreted as the integral of the multiplication of the two functions. So the convolution theorem is given by that if we suppose that we have the Laplace of our first function is given by Laplace of f1t is equal to f1 of s, and similarly the Laplace of the second function, that is Laplace of f2t, is given as f2 of s, then what happens that the Laplace of the integral 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx will be nothing but simple multiplication of the Laplace transforms of the two functions. So it will be the multiplication of f1s and f2s. So this is the graph of the function, where you can say that when the t is lying between a and a plus epsilon, the value of the function is very, very high. It is having a high value because it is 1 by epsilon. So since epsilon value is very, very small, it is tending to 0. So 1 by epsilon will be tending to infinity. So it is a continuous function and it is having a finite value. So we have taken the functions, the Laplace as Laplace of 0 to t, f1x into f2 of t minus x dx is nothing but the multiplication of f1s into f2s. So we have this, and if we take this Laplace to the other side, so the convolution theorem for the inverse Laplace transform will be given as inverse Laplace f1s into f2s is nothing but the integral 0 to t multiplication of the two functions f1x into f2 of t minus x dx. So this is the statement of the convolution theorem. Now let's discuss about the proof of the convolution theorem. So we start with the proof. So we take the left hand side of the equation of the convolution theorem. You have this equation. So we have taken the left hand side. So we say that we have to apply the Laplace transform on the function, that is 0 to t integral f1x into f2 of t minus x dx. So we can apply the basic definition of the Laplace transform. We know that Laplace of ft is nothing but 0 to infinity e to the power minus st ft dt. And this whole bracketed term is now our f of t. So we shall substitute the value. So we have the equation. That equation is now 0 to infinity e to the power minus st. For ft, we have this whole bracketed term, that is integral 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx into dt. So you can see we get the equation as integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus st, and we have another integral 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx into dt. So we have to solve our two integrals. So basically, to solve the or to get the result of the convolution theorem, the question is to solve the double integrals. So what we see here, if we see this integral, we know according to the Bodmer's rule also, first the inner bracket is solved and then we go out and expand the other terms. So first, in this way, we have to first solve the inner integral, that is the integral upon the variable x, and when we get the when we have solved the integral for the x variable, then we shall be calculating the second integral, which is over the variable t. So what I am going to say is that first we will have to solve this integral, which is over the variable x. When we substitute the values of x, and since the limit is for x is equal to 0 to t. So our equation will be now in terms of t, and then we shall solve the second integral, which is over the variable dt. or we can say it is over the variable t, and the t is having the limits from 0 to infinity. So I have mentioned here that this first integral, you can see that this integral is over the t variable, and this t variable integral is lying in the first quadrant, as you can see that the limits of t is from 0 to infinity. So the integral is over the t variable, which is lying in the first quadrant, and it is extending to infinity. And then the double integral, the second integral, will be taken over the variable x. You can see that the variable is x, and it is also in the first quadrant, where the x values are varying from 0 to t, or x is varying from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to t. So the double integral is taken over the region extending to infinity, which is also lying in the first quadrant, and it is lying between the lines x is equal to 0 and x is equal to t. So I have mentioned here that first we will have to solve the integral with respect to s, because according to Bodmer, first the inner bracket is solved. So first we have to solve it for the x integral, which is having the limits from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to t. And when we get the values for this first integral, which is over the x variable, then we shall integrate with respect to the second variable, which is respect to t, and the limits for t are from 0 to infinity. So if we draw a graph for this function, what we find here? We find here that if we take the t-axis along the x-axis of the xy quadrant, and we take the x along the y quadrant, y-axis of the xy quadrant, that is the first quadrant, so we know that the t value is varying from 0 to infinity. So you can see this line, that the t value is varying from 0 to infinity, where the x is between the lines x is equal to 0 and x is equal to t. So this is x is equal to t line, and the t is varying from 0 to infinity. So the area under the curve is this. The shaded portion, blue shaded portion that you can see, is the slower portion between below the line x is equal to t. So let me again clear you that the limits were for t, the limits were from 0 to t is equal to infinity. So from t is equal to infinity means that you have this line. If this is infinity point, so t is equal to infinity is this line, and t is equal to 0 is this line. And for limits of x, the x limits are from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to t. So x is equal to 0 means x is equal to 0 is this line parallel to the x-axis. So x is equal to 0, and x is equal to t is which line? So x is equal to t is this line, which is also extending to infinity, because t is extending to infinity. So the area under the curve is, since t's value is in extending from 0 to infinity, and x value is from 0 to x is equal to t, so the area under the curve is this region. So we will have to calculate this area under the region, because we know that when we have double integrals, when we have to solve double integrals, so double integral mean is to calculate the area under the curve. So the area under the curve that is required to be calculated is this shaded portion that is shaded in this blue color. So we have to calculate this area, which will be the result of the convolution theorem. So once we are able to calculate this area, we shall get the desired result. So now what we see, that since we have to solve two integrals, so we can solve this double integral by interchanging the order of integration also. So what I do is I interchange the order of integral. So if we change the order of integration, that is, first I shall not be solving it for x variable, I shall be integrating my expression over the t variable, and then I shall integrate over the x variable. But accordingly, the area under the curve which has to be solved is this shaded region itself. So if I want to change the order of integration, then there will be certainly a change in the limits of the x and t. So the t and x values will be changed for the integral in which we change the order of integral. So the area under the curve remains the same. You can see, so you can see that the area under the curve is same. That is this blue portion. Just what we are going to change, we are going to change the order of integration. Instead of first integrating with respect to and then integrating with respect to t, now we shall just integrate first with respect to t and then respect to x. So when this takes place, what will happen, that the values of the limits of the x and t variables will be changed. But we will have to keep in the mind that the area under the curve that has to be solved remains the same. So what happens now, that when we have to integrate with respect to t first, so the t value will be taken as that this t equation is t is equal to x line, and the t is equal to x line will be extending till t equal to infinity. So t will take the limits that t is equal to x and t equal to infinity, because in one of the equations of x we had x is equal to t. So we have just interchanged x equal to t by t equal to x. So now the lower limit of t will be x and the upper limit of t will be infinity. So we will have the limits that t is equal to x and t equal to infinity. And this, since this is t equal to x line and this is the t is equal to infinity line, so the values of x will be now from x is equal to 0, and the value of x will be in extending till x is equal to infinity, so that the area under the curve is again the same portion, that is the lower portion, that is the below portion, the line x is equal to t or t equal to x. Question, we have this line t is equal to x and this t is equal to x line is extending to infinity, and the x value is taking the value from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to infinity, such that the area under the portion is again the same resultant equation. I think you are clear that first we were integrating with respect to x between the limits x is equal to 0 and x is equal to t, and then we integrated with respect to t from t is equal to 0 to t equal to infinity. Upon interchanging the order of integration, we shall first integrate with respect to t between the limits t is equal to x and t equal to infinity, and then we shall integrate with respect to x from the limits x is equal to 0 to infinity, such that the area under the curve which has to be calculated remains the same. So we had this equation that Laplace of 0 to t f1x into f2t minus x dx will be written as 0 to infinity to the power minus st. For ft we have this whole term into dt. So now what we shall do, we shall not integrate first over the x variable and then over the t variable. We are going to change the order of integration. So when we change the order of integration, what we find, that the x integration is over the limit 0 to infinity. You can see here that the limits of x is now from 0 to infinity, and the t variable, that the integration over the t variable is now from x to infinity. So since we get this term as e to the power minus st f1x into f2t minus x dt, so we shall first integrate over the t variable, and the answer we get, we shall integrate over the x variable. So we have made a substitution that we have multiplied our e to the power minus st by e to the power sx and e to the power minus sx. So base same powers are added. So we get the term e to the power minus s t minus x plus x and minus x. That makes no difference. So now we shall break the two terms. So we have broken up our exponential term in two parts as e to the power minus s t minus x and e to the power minus sx. Since the function 2 is having the variable t minus x, so we have club the exponential e to the power minus st minus x with the f2 function f2 of t minus s, and we have club e to the power minus sx into f1x into dt. Now, since the integration is over the t variable and this two terms e to the power minus sx into f1x does not contain any t term, so it is taken out of the integral. So we have taken out of the integral. So what we get? We get 0 to infinity to the power minus sx f1x dx, and the second integral is from x to infinity e to the power minus s t minus x f2 of t minus x into dt. So to solve the second integral, what we make a substitution that we put our t minus x quantity equal to w. So if we derivate it, so we get dt is equal to dw. So the limits of t are from x to infinity. So when we put t equal to x in this above equation, so what we get the value of w equal to 0, because when we put t equal to x, so x minus x will be 0. So w is tending to 0. And when we put t tending to infinity, so obviously w will also tend to infinity. So correspondingly, the limits of w are now from 0 to infinity. So we can see here for the second integral, the result is 0 to infinity integral e to the power minus sw f2w into dw. And the first integral is 0 to infinity e to the power minus sx f1x into dx. So we have now two independent integrals, and you can see that both the two independent integrals is the what? Is the basic definition of the Laplace transform. So we can substitute for the first integral. The value of the first integral could be written as f1s, and the value of the second integral could be written as f2 of s. So this proves our theorem that the Laplace of 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx is nothing but the multiplication of the Laplace transforms of the individual functions, that is the multiplication of f1s into f2s. So we have proved the theorem, we have proved our convolution theorem. So the major part that was to be considered is to how to evaluate the integral, because we have to solve double integrals. So double integral means we have to calculate the area under the curve. So we have now seen what is the area and how we can calculate. And we know that if we want to calculate the area, area is what? Area means that it is just the multiplication of length and breadth. So if we want to calculate the length and breadth, it doesn't mean that we have always to multiply first length and then breadth. We can multiply breadth into height also. So that is why we could change the order of integration. So we have changed the order of integration. When we change the order of integration, the limits values changed, and accordingly we were able to solve our integral in very fruitful manner, and we came and at the resultant part very quickly. Otherwise, the calculation would have been very lengthy, and this is one of the alternative method to get the result. So I hope that you have understood the convolution theorem, that the Laplace of integral 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx is nothing but f1s into f2s. And if we take this Laplace to the other side, so we get the equation that Laplace inverse of f1s into f2s is integral 0 to t f1x into f2 of t minus x dx. So I hope that you have understood the convolution theorem. And now let's study an example of a problem related to the convolution theorem. So we have this equation, we have this problem that we have to find the convolution of integral 0 to t e to the power minus e to the power plus x sine of t minus x dx. So we can judge this, since it is in the terms of t minus x, the function is expressed as t minus of x. Therefore, we shall choose our first function f1x as e to power x, and the sine function as f2 of t minus x will be sine of t minus x. So if we want to apply the convolution theorem, So we have to just calculate the Laplace transform of individual functions. So we don't have to think what is will be the Laplace of t minus x. We have to just calculate the Laplace of the sine function. So we can say that the Laplace of f1x will be f1s, which will be the Laplace of e to the power x. And we know that e to the power ax Laplace is 1 upon s minus a, and the a value is here 1. So we get 1 upon s minus 1. And the Laplace of sine function is 1 upon s square plus 1, because a is again 1 here. So it is a upon s square plus a square. So we get 1 upon s square plus 1 as the second f2s. So the Laplace of 0 to t to the power x sine of t minus x will be nothing but the multiplication of the individuals f1s and f2s. So which will be the resultant of the multiplication of the function, that is 1 upon s minus 1 and 1 upon s square plus 1. So this is the answer of the integral 0 to t e to the power x sine of t minus x. So you can see how simplified manner, how easy manner you can able to solve the integral 0 to t to the power x sine tx. So this is the physical significance of the convolution theorem, that you can apply the Laplace transform to the multiplication of the two functions, and even though we have to calculate the integral of the multiplication of two functions. So in using the convolution theorem, it is just a one-step method to calculate the integral. So thank you, and meet you in the next session of the Laplace transform. Hope we meet you again. Thank you.